So humans move. Our arms reach out, our knees collapse, our heads nod, our chests cave in, our backs arch, we clench our fists, we jump, we shrug, we pick each other up, we push each other away. And for me, this is language as much as it is action. This is what the body has to say about need, defeat, courage, despair, desire, joy, ambivalence, frustration, love. I think that these images resonate meaningfully in our minds because we have all felt these things so purely in our bodies. We have been moved. And I'm a choreographer and I work with the body because I'm convinced about this. And I'm trying to create performances where audiences can connect to their own bodies through the dancer and to see themselves, to recognize their own experiences and their own dramas translated into fierce physical language. And I want to create a shared world in the theater where we discover something, that we find each other through the language of the body, the language of the body that is beyond words and that is something unwritten and very, very present. I want to focus my talk today on conflict. In my life, I avoid conflict like the plague, like a lot of us. But in my work, it has been vital. And I'm not talking about conflict in the studio while we create. I'm talking about the conflict that comes up when you have contrasting ideas set against each other inside the subject of a work. So, for example, certainty and doubt. Or conflicting physical tasks within the body that create states of torque or exertion. I find it really compelling to see a performer just dancing right on the very edge of their ability. It's compelling to see that, and I think that there's conflict inherent in the effort of trying to achieve something that is really difficult. It's either physically tricky or complicated or really fast or really tiring. The name of my dance company is Kid Pivot. And pivot is that precise and technical move that changes your direction, that changes your point of view. And it evokes a sense of skill and a sense of rigor. And Kid is for the outlaw and the pirate and the prize fighter. And that's, for me, that's about recklessness and a kind of aggressive freedom. So it's the tension between these two ideas that I'm really striving to attain in my work. I want to make choreography that is detailed and beautiful and precise, but I also want to make choreography that's messed up and brutal and brave. And it's not about balance. Balance feels still and peaceful. So I'm looking for the energy that is created by tension, the tension between rigor and recklessness, between the intellect and the instinct, between the need to respect traditional ways and the need to subvert them. So this moves me. This feels like a dance that I want to do. This year, I choreographed a piece for a company that I've been working with on and off for the last 7 years. They're called Netherlands Dance Theater. And the piece that I made, it just premiered in February, is called Solo Echo. It's in its entirety, it's about 20 minutes long, and I'm going to show you a couple of clips from it today. But the impetus for the work was a couple of Brahms sonatas for cello and piano. And this is music I've been listening to for 20 years. It's like a touchstone for me. And I didn't feel ready to create to it, to choreograph to it until now. And even now I was feeling pretty terrified about getting it wrong or not doing it justice. I really care about this music. But Solo Echo presents an everyman character reckoning with himself at the end of his life. And the character is repeated, copied, echoed, reiterated through seven dancers. Seven different dancers, so he's portrayed by both male and female bodies and through different physiques and strengths. So each performer is a really distinct and kind of nuanced version of the character, and the connections between them evoke, I hope, a man coming to terms with himself. So my original idea was to costume the dancers so that they all looked exactly like the same guy. And we brought in a wig and beard master from Rotterdam, who we spent many hours trying to get everybody looking exactly the same. Okay, I pressed the space bar? Okay. Okay, so there they all are. That's them in rehearsal. The seven, it's not everybody, but... So I was really excited about the potency of this. It looked amazing. It looked weird, and it looked distinct, and yeah, I thought it really had potential to connect people to the subject of a man in dialogue with himself and confronting himself and accepting himself and also losing himself. So I kept this. Here's another. If I press this space, where will the next one come up? There they are, more on stage and in costume. I kept the wigs and the beards right up until the dress rehearsal, and then I scrapped them right before the show. Sometimes that happens. And I guess I felt like the piece had taken a different direction. It was really human, and it was poetic, and it was quite sad. And I wanted people to watch that. I didn't want people just to watch wigs and beards. So I scrapped them. I just wanted them to watch the humans dancing. So I'm going to keep that stuff for the next show, because I really, it's very exciting. I don't know what I'm going to do with it, but now I know how it looks. So the first movement of the piece is expressed through solos and duets that are sometimes exuberant and passionate, sometimes more aggressive and urgent. So these are the states of a person in the prime of life. And the music, the allegro, resonates with that kind of ambition and power. So I was exploring physical states of speed and flow and that energizing conflict inside the body that I was talking to you about, between inside a single body, but also between bodies. So here are three little clips from that part. Okay, command and thing. Help, I already messed it up. Sorry, Mark. Oh, because I can't see it. Okay, now I just press it. The space bar. Thank you. That's a couple of clips from the first movement. And then the second movement is set to the more soulful adagio. And with this part, I was working on the idea of creating a single entity made out of the seven dancers. So a collective body with unfolding and collapsing structures that required a lot of cooperation and coordination and consonance between the dancers. So its component parts are individuals. But as a whole, it is its own expansive and complex being. And I was thinking that the same yearning that is present in the single character could be manifested exponentially. So here's the last little bit of that part. Oh. So clearly cooperation is really essential to that movement. And in trying to say something about acceptance and loss, I had to put conflict aside and deliver something really different than that. I love working with large groups of people sometimes. It can be stressful managing everybody, but I feel like I can get to certain images and states that I can't get to with a small group. I'm going to show you another clip. I'm just going to talk while it's playing. So in 2007, I made another piece for Netherlands Dance Theater called The Second Person. And this is one of my first times working with a puppet. But there are 24 people in this piece. And you can't see them right now, but there are actually 24 people that are puppeteering that puppet. Well, there's actually only 5 people puppeteering it, but there are 24 people attached to those 5 people. And so this was an image for me that, that spoke of connection between us and that sense of us all being the same. I love having these two options in my life, my own company, which is very small, and have a very intimate and intense relationship with the people I work with there. It's a small-scale operation. I'm very much on the ground with it. But with NDT, I'm able to work big. I have bigger budgets, more dancers, more support. So I really enjoy having those two things. They both feed each other, and they both inform each other about how to work. There they are. The first scene of the piece, and this is a little clip from the very last scene of the piece. So in between these scenes there's a lot of conflict. But this piece is again more about a collective effort. If I have 90 more seconds-ish, I'm just going to read one last thing in closing, because I'm really looking forward to your questions, so I'll just finish with this. This is a little something I wrote for International Dance Day. Did you know there was an International Dance Day? There is. There's an International Dance Day. So I wrote this a couple of years for that. You are dancers, all of you. Life moves you. Life dances you. To dance is to investigate and experience. Try that again. Investigate this and celebrate the experience of being alive. Like life, a dance creates and destroys itself in every moment. Like love, it is beyond reason. Ephemeral as breath, concrete as bone, dance is made of you. You sculpt space. You write with your body in a wordless language that is deeply understood. You grace the space within and around you when you dance. Force, trajectory, inertia, and recovery. Dancing is a ride, a duet between your instinct and imagination. To dance is to heighten your experience of the present moment. Your body is your location. When you dance, you are profoundly engaged in being there. So that's it for now. We'll talk a little bit more after that. Thank you.
We usually start with us asking a question, and I have one. I would like to, not everybody in this room are talented dancers like you and I. So, why don't you share with us how a little insight into how your process works? Like, I think about what it would be to produce something that complex and how to organize those movements and those people, and where does that come from? How do you envision that? How do you plan that? Where does the inspiration come from? Can you talk a little? I know it's a pretty sort of low-hanging fruit question, but specifically related to dance, I think it's really compelling. I bet you very few of us have any comprehension of how that process works.
You mean how do you make choreography?
How the hell do you make choreography?
So there are different ways to do it. It's been interesting the last couple of years because I had a baby recently, and so I haven't been able to dance as much, and I've been having to really rely on my words to be able to direct and to be able to create movement. And normally I used to always build everything in my own body and demonstrate it, and people would learn it, and we would start off from there. But these days I've been having to talk people through it. And I'm, you know, I surround myself with really amazing dancers. I'm lucky that way. So I have very creative people around me who are able to interpret and translate words into their bodies and make them physical. I'll give you an example maybe of how I might direct someone verbally, and maybe that'll give, so I would say, if I had an imaginary dancer in front of me, I would say, okay, you're gonna let your left knee collapse. And as you're dropping towards the floor, you're gonna interrupt the fall by throwing the back of your head around to the left. And as you spiral upwards, you're going to find a way to jump to your right, and your right foot's gonna shoot out and it's gonna land behind you, and you're gonna stop in a kind of big lunge position, crossed over this way. From there, you're gonna take the whole image and just drop it. So you're just gonna let it sink. I use lots of sound effects too, because it's helpful for people to know. They like, yeah. And then from here, you're gonna have a punching action, but instead of using your fist, you're gonna use your shoulder. And you're gonna hit downwards. And as you do that, you're gonna rebound upwards, and you're gonna catch, as if you're catching a ball with the back of your neck. Conk. So it might be a series of impulses like that. And that starts to build a phrase that they then learn and repeat and refine and expand and change and so on. So when I choreograph a piece, I usually start by making phrases of movement like that on each dancer that I'm working with. This is just something I've been doing lately. There's lots of ways to do this, but lately this is what I've been doing. Make a phrase of movement like that on each dancer, and that by the time they each have their own phrase of movement, maybe takes 20 seconds to execute the phrase. Then everybody learns everybody else's phrase. Then everybody shares a lot of choreographic material. Then we learn it really, really well. We learn it so we can do it backwards and forwards and upside down and inside out and all different fronts and using the ceiling as the front, all kinds of different ways of dealing with that phrase, all those phrases of material. Now we have a mountain of material to work with. Now I'm ready to start making the piece because now I have my paints, my brushes, my canvases, all my stuff. It's like they're ready to be worked with. It doesn't have any meaning yet. It doesn't have any structure. It's just sort of random dance moves ready to be used. And then there's the process of applying it to the content of the work. Using a theme and trying to find ways or look through, or sort of dig through that movement that I have and find what if this movement will apply to this subject? What are these phrases? Which one of these phrases can I use to say something about manipulation or control or about vulnerability or about striving for something? So it kind of goes like that.
Yeah, no big deal. It's like cooking, right? No big deal. Yeah, whatever, you just wing it. Who has a question? Tell us who you are and ask a question.
Hi, my name's Christina. And we talked mainly about you had a comment, you said balance is boring. Mm. And that you look for, in your work, you look for tension. And that, you know, you talked about recklessness and rigor and whatever. And how is it that you find those moments of tension or the two things? And how do you know which ones are going to explode into creativity? So how do you find... Yeah, I mean, how do you find that tension? And how do you turn that into creativity?
Mm-hmm. Well, there's so many different sort of levels of doing that. There's like the micro level within the body. So like these little tiny, like I was saying earlier, conflicting physical tasks. So for example, turning your head to the left and turning your hips to the right and trying to deal with those two ideas in your body. So that creates conflict right away. Reaching down with your left arm and twisting your nose around to the other side. So two points of two ideas that are spiraling in two different directions, and then the rest of you has to choose which one you're going to follow. So I can either follow my head, or I can like follow my hand down. So you kind of find that little point of tension, and then the release is also really interesting. I might grab my head this way, and then as my head releases, it sends me into a movement there. So so that's the micro level of finding little conflicts in the body that are interesting and build energy. And then inside the larger picture, the meta conflicts of the work, it's really about trying to have ideas coexisting. So maybe I'm trying to do something really poetic on stage, something beautiful and very human and very subtle. And as that's happening, everything on stage is crashing down around. This is an extreme example, but you know, trying to find ways to subvert or to stick a wedge into what I'm doing that will change things up. Those kinds of conflicts. I think that's what you mean by discovering where the points of tension could be. Yeah? Okay.
So I found it really interesting when you said paint and canvas. My question is around how do you deal with ego, personality, dancers, empty vessel versus somebody who comes in with an opinion of their own? How do you manage that? And I think you know, that question around the project management of it, mm-hmm. the idea of the technical having a vision and having 24 people be able to see that vision and sort of give their body to you, it's amazing. Mm. I want to be a dancer.
Mm. Well, by the time you get to that level of dancer, by the time you're working with people at that level, there are no more issues in terms of personality and all that. Ugh, you don't have to deal with that. There's so many dancers out there, and there's so many talented dancers. You don't have to ever choose to work with someone who's not going to be willing and involved and creative and open and loving in the process. So I've been really lucky that way. But I'm lucky because I've been able to work with such high caliber people. That said, I want to work with a personality. I want to work with an ego and with an agenda and with a need and with all that, all those human qualities that are interesting and complex. Like that's why I do what I do. So it's finding a way to deliver that to the audience and not let it be a block in the studio, I guess. It's interesting, I'm just remounting a piece. I had choreographed it on one dancer and now I've replaced him with another. And the first guy was had a lot of, in his dancing and in the way he portrayed the character in the piece, he was very vulnerable and had an incredible sense of flow and collapse in his body. And it was beautiful to see that. And it really took the role in one direction. The new guy is he's faster and he's harder and he's more aggressive in his dancing, not in his personality, but in his movement. So I'm trying to figure out how to bring that quality out in the character this time and how I can kind of rejig the content to suit. No, follow the lead of this guy that is more brutal. Yeah, tougher. Follow him and like let that inform how we work and what the piece becomes. But in terms of dealing with a personality, I very rarely come in. I have no conflicts in the studio. Yeah, lucky that way.
If only it was like that in my business. let's try the back corner. Who had their hand up? I just saw one. Okay, which one of you has a better question? Come on. Yours is good.
How important to you is it for the audience to grasp your intended meaning?
That's a really good question. Yeah. It's a really good one. It's very important to me that the audience connects to the performance in some way. If they grasp my intended meaning, I hope that would be nice, but it's not so important. What I hope is that they are able to connect and get involved in whatever way they want to. And I always try to create lots of different pathways into the work. So some people connect more to the physicality, the visceral feeling of watching someone dance. Other people need text or something, more wordy maybe, or maybe a set design element or a costume or music. You know, so there's different ways into a work. And I try to offer lots of different entry points into what I'm doing and different levels and layers of meaning. But it is important to me. I really want people to connect. I want them to like the show. I really do. I want them to have a good time. Is it the main important thing? I think if I wasn't, if I wasn't striving to connect with people and to share something, I don't think there's really much point. So yeah, I would say it's pretty much the most important thing. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
You've kind of answered our sort of question in some ways. We were talking about how there's real expression apparent when an individual's dancing, and yet when there's a big group of people dancing together, there's an incredible amount of collaboration and cooperation, which led me to the question of individual creativity from your dancers versus yourself truly directing exactly what they're doing. And just what is that interplay like in your practice of working with them, allowing them, or really trying to control what they do? How does that work?
Often it depends on how much time I have and who I'm working with. With my own company, I'm able to really deliver some broad strokes and say, this is what the scene wants to look like. This is how I want you to connect. This is the material I want us to use. Can you help me find a way to make a structure of seven dancers that collapses and falls apart and pops this guy out at the end? So everybody will contribute an idea, and then I'll go in there, because it's complex, right? So I can't work it out. Okay, your elbow's going to go behind her ear, and then as her, you know, it's going to take forever. So they all offer up something that will kind of give me a rough sketch of that idea, and then I'll go in and finesse it and say things. Okay, your elbow needs to go behind her ear on the way down, and she'll catch her by the hair and, you know, all that stuff. So we could fill it out that way. I don't have a lot of time to talk about this today, but improv. So improvisation is really important to me, both in the process and in the performance. And I use improv a lot as a tool to create, as a way to generate. But also, I leave windows of improvisation in the performance so that there's usually a little window. Like, maybe it's just a few seconds, maybe it's a whole scene, but that it's improvised. And I think that's really important. It energizes the work, it keeps us alive, it keeps us thinking, it opens up parts of us that that need to stay in touch with the unknown. So I think it's always a combo, and I have to respond to the parameters of time too. So if I have only 3 weeks to create a piece, then I need to go in there a lot more prepared and be a lot more specific about what I ask for if I want to get it. Like that. Yeah.
We have one back here.
Hi, I was really interested in what you had to say about how you create all these different movements and have a lot of options before you even start choreographing a piece. How you sort of said you had a mountain of options, basically, of movements. And that's kind of very different from, I have a design background, and I find that you try to draw, you try to simplify and find the specific way to communicate, but I just found it really interesting how you say, okay, well, we create all of this, and then we see what works best together. I'm just wondering if you could elaborate on how you find what pieces are the pieces that make the work. You know, as the end video showed, when all those people were sort of flowing together, mm-hmm. I don't have a lot of dance knowledge, but it was just really interesting that. So just how do you get to that point and see what to use?
Well, maybe I'll use that scene as an example of how I would make something. So the final scene, the woman, weirdly her name is Mariette, so weird. She looks like a marionette. I choreographed a series of movements on her just solo. So just made a phrase of movement on her without a lot of intent, just do this, do that, this looks cool, this is beautiful, just made something without a lot of intent. Then I had about four or five people attach themselves to her and enable her to do the movement in a more expansive way. So for example, she might have sent her leg over like this, but now somebody's going to grab her knee and they're going to move her while she does that leg move, right? So it expands what she's doing. So then I built, then I start to choreograph, you know, beyond her. And then there's like another layer, like an onion, of people that I attach to those people that would be able to connect and move them and so on, and build the scene that way. Does that answer your question, or are you talking more about how to apply movement to content? Uh-huh. Yeah. It really is an excavation. So I like you.
You know what it is for.
Sometimes it's instinct. Sometimes not. Sometimes it's just
the graphic designers in the room will get me. It's sketching. She's sketching. Uh-huh. And then when you come up with, you know, 100 ideas, and you see, well, there's a germ there, and there's a kernel there, and there's an idea there, before we ever involve the client, the audience, and going back to the brief to make sure we're solving that problem, we're looking to cluster things together that will work, right? I mean, Isn't that what you're doing? You're yeah, sketching ideas so. And looking for, mm-hmm. for things to work together. That's how I see it.
Anthony Rowland from England. I'm sorry I don't know your work, so I'm going completely by what we've seen here. And the question is to do with a graphic quality that you have, especially the second section where you have the men dressed very dark and all their arms naked. Because of the poor projection here, one actually only really saw their arms. And it really looked like what Paul Klee said, taking a line for a walk. Mm. It was so extraordinary. And I just wondered if you sketched graphically designs as part of preparing your choreography.
I do. Takes a long time to draw stuff like that. And I use a video a lot, so I might sketch something physically in the room and then videotape it, and that becomes like a moving sketch in a way, and I collect those images. I do a lot of writing and a lot of drawing and things, but not so much about the body, more just about structures and directions and pathways and kind of maps of how dancers might move in space rather than actual individual bodies. So I usually have it up in my head. The body, actually, yeah.
We have, wow, look, okay. We're gonna do one, because it's like 1 minute to 10 already. Look at this. All right, you know what? We're gonna do, Vikram, is that you? I will answer that phone. We're gonna do this young lady right here, because it is also her birthday.
Oh. Hello.
Hi.
I just, I'm so inspired, and thank you so much for sharing your art with us. My question is actually about how you find inspiration, like as you move through the world, and you know, we're movement is part of what we do constantly, so I would be surprised if you said you weren't constantly inspired, but I'd like to hear about that.
Inspiration is a tricky one, I find. I collect lots of ideas, and I'm certainly inspired by the people that are around me, the people that I'm working with. They inspire me every day about how to build movement and how to create something for the stage. But I don't really trust in inspiration. I don't trust that I'm ever going to have it. I don't rely on it. I rely on working. I just work on things. I craft things. I focus on the craft of something. If I think of myself as a craftsperson rather than an artist, then I can busy myself with a task, and then if inspiration comes along, great, and if not, it's okay, I don't really need it. I can just keep making stuff, and eventually it comes and has a form, and I can build it. So, craft, I guess. Thanks. Thanks.